Hi, I'm Jim Jocko. Welcome to Numerics Video Blog with me again, Satyam Controller, SVP of Client Solutions Group at Numerics. Hi, Satyam, how are you?
Hi, Jim.
Continuing our conversation, if you didn't catch our last video blog, we went on the ABCs of the CSA. Today, you know, clearly we talked a little bit about the challenges as it relates around funding, the changes in the LIBOR OIS, availability of high-quality collateral, especially in this environment. But today I wanted to talk about the potential valuation challenges around that in terms of managing that optionality within the embedded CSA itself. Clearly, it's posing more and more of a challenge for individual banks.
Definitely. I think there are valuation challenges post-execution, there are pricing challenges pre-execution, and institutions are looking to a way in which they can optimize upon all the terms that are embedded in the CSA. So what is the best way for me to deal with all the different terms? Which counterparty should I execute with? Is the spread that I'm being charged by my counterparty, is that the only criterion? Or do I look at other things that are embedded in the CSA which could come back and hurt me later when I'm ready to unwind, or later when there is a credit event perhaps, or a CSA that's going to be very stringent from a liquidity perspective?
You know, you touched on something also very interesting. So clearly we can see the changes in valuation, which in and of itself, we might have different books between the accounting books and how the derivatives are being valued in the back office, but also within the front office and how they're being managed. So that raises two questions for me. Price transparency, right? If I'm thinking about managing all the optionality within the CSA as part of my pre-trade thought process, it seems like there's a lot of areas that could go wrong.
Yeah, there is just a huge number of areas that needs to be taken into account, the different curves, the different different types of instruments that one can post as collateral. And here's where institutions have to examine and have a very clear collateral management policy that starts at the beginning before execution, at the pre-trade stage, and goes through all the way through daily collateral management.
So in terms of now on the opposite side, what kind of challenges if the deal is traded in terms of the novation process as part of an unwind?
Yeah. I think there are pricing challenges both pre-trade or at unwind, and what that means is that because of all the terms in the CSA, counterparties are more likely to disagree about what the fair price is, and that's fine from a trading perspective. That's fine. It just means that the transactions are being allocated in the optimal way to take into account credit risk and liquidity risk and so on, and that's fine. The big challenge, of course, is on the unwind, and at that point, the role of the valuation agent is really important, and it's really important to clarify the valuation approaches that counterparties use and the valuation agent that one chooses. In fact, for institutions that are entering into contracts with banks, it's really advisable to understand the exact methodology that's going to be applied to the trade at unwind, and setting that and understanding that right at the beginning will really help institutions to understand the entire life cycle of the transaction. And in some cases, institutions are also agreeing to a known third party who is a provider of valuations. Once if there is a certain level of disagreement, actually the standard ISDA CSA does not really explain in a lot of detail what to do with disputes on valuation challenges, and it's very important to get that ironed out early on.
Now, you mentioned the standard CSA. You know, clearly some challenges as it relates to implementation, we're not there yet in terms of the market itself, but clearly one would presume there's going to be challenges managing, I think as we kind of joked in the last webinar, you know, the warehouse of CSAs that were kind of in the basement that are now in the forefront against the new standardized CSA. You know, how are institutions thinking about the disparity between the contracts?
Yeah, I think the standard CSA is an attempt by the industry bodies, you know, ISDA in particular is taking the lead to create a standard agreement that would serve as the basis for the large proportion of banks that deal in derivatives. Now, what's important to realize is that the CSA is ultimately a bilateral contract, and it takes into account the particularities of those counterparties, their credit position, their liquidity position, etc. And therefore, to have a one-size-fits-all is also not practical, and we will see that there will be several institutions and several cases where you have CSAs between a very highly rated counterparty and a lower rated counterparty, and you may have unilateral CSAs, or you may have CSAs that are skewed in some way simply because one counterparty is weaker than the other. So overall, we will see more and more adoption of the standardized CSA, particularly in the interbank market, but we will continue to see some other types of CSAs.
You know, that comment brings me back to reading a report post-financial crisis. In terms of the number of defaults in the market, they were very, very low. But where the biggest market challenge was dealing with the increased probability of default. How does that play into an organization's approach in terms of collateral management and the CSA itself?
Exactly. I think that's a very important point. It's the probability of default and it's the liquidity issues actually that cause the biggest stresses. And therefore, as institutions think about counterparty risk when they look at CSAs, it's very important for them to look at liquidity issues as well and really think through the collateral issues, really think through the collateral clauses and the credit clauses that go in the contract, because it's very likely that the next crisis is also something that causes liquidity challenges rather than actual defaults.
Okay. Well, Satyam, thank you very much. And I think one of the things that I hear kind of thematically from you is the middle and back office and front office, they're all kind of coming together, and it's a end-to-end process, which is probably that new risk management framework. Thank you for
Absolutely.
Coming today. We'll see you next time. Please follow us at NX Analytics on Twitter, as well as our blog on